large piece of, let's see that. At least I'm assuming it is. Actually, I'm looking closely. They're pretty cool. Yeah. And so you can do exciting things like implement your favorite Instagram filters or Snapchat or whatever it is that we use now. I feel like it changes every year or two. Okay, so we get a very dramatic photographs of shoes in front of German building. Or whatever this is. I don't know. This is what I found in here. Okay. Right. So one thing that's worth noting from the start here is that we're going to go back to doing some 2D math. So we're going to take this class full circle. Right? We've spent quite a lot of time doing 3D rendering and camera projections and all this kind of stuff. But the nice thing about image processing as a part of computer graphics is that largely it disregards the 3D content. Right? Like when you're writing Photoshop filters and these sorts of things, typically, although this is beginning to not be the case anymore, a lot of the filters you have for images really are just processing images as two-dimensional functions over the image plane, because that's all they got. And there are a lot of different contexts where image processing comes up, right? It's not just writing, you know, Photoshop filters, but these days, actually, one of the principal places where they appear is actually in writing shaders, right? So if you remember, we have this graphics pipeline where we just have buffers, and essentially you can call OpenGL as many times as you want to iterate over the buffer and do some type of calculation over it and make a new buffer, right? Now, a very typical thing to do in your video game might be to first render your scene, for example, in a sharp way, and then iterate over it in another pass to kind of blur stuff in the background to, for example, simulate some kind of depth of field or something like that, right? And so exactly the same algorithms and principles apply in both of these scenarios, okay? So one of the basic questions that we have to ask here is when I talk about image processing and editing pixel colors and so on, we first have to define what is an image. And really, there's sort of two dual viewpoints that if you read through the literature, people tend to conflate them quite a bit. On the one hand, obviously, if we're talking about writing, you know, things that are processing buffers on your computer and so on, we're thinking about images as two-dimensional arrays of pixel colors. Right? And certainly in this class, we spent quite a lot of time figuring out how to fill these arrays, process them, understand what's inside of them, display them, and so on. On the other hand, one thing to note, which is a little bit flipped backward from what we've done in the rest of this class, is you'll notice that a lot of image processing, actually, if you read through the literature, thinks about images as two-dimensional functions, which makes sense, right? Essentially, it's a function from your position on the image to color. But notice that's exactly backward from what we've done in the rest of this class, right? Where we started with a continuum, you know, distribution like a light field or whatever that we're going to render on the computer screen, and we've discretized it. Here, maybe I have a photograph or something that I've rendered into, you know, a buffer on my GPU, right? Which is fundamentally just a 2D array of colors. I don't have anything in between. But I'm going to assume that it's dense enough that it's some pretty good approximation of a smooth continuum image, which is what my eye really sees. And so oftentimes, it's perfectly reasonable to talk about image processing as just something that takes in a two-dimensional function and gives back another one, which is like, you know, it takes in the pixel color at every point and gives back the pixel color at every point and somehow edit it. And so there are these two dual viewpoints, and unfortunately, if you like start reading through, you know, research papers and textbooks on this topic, I think there's sort of a division in terms of the best way to interpret this. But algorithmically, it'll be pretty clear. And roughly, in case you guys need a user guide to translate from one to the other, here it is that essentially any time that you have a sum over your image, you know, if you make your pixels small enough, essentially you're approximating some integral, and vice versa. Yeah. And so, really, unlike a lot of areas of math, it's very easy to translate from the continuum version to the discrete one, just by kind of squinting your eyes the right way. All right, so incidentally, a lot of the filters that we talk about also apply to video. And of course, there's a completely reasonable way to think about a video, which is just as a 3D array of pixel colors, or as a function of x, y, and time. Yeah? In fact, there are a lot of really interesting image processing techniques that essentially say, okay, you know, if I think about it, you know, a video strip is really like a big cube of numbers, right? Where you have, you know, the spatial coordinates and then you have the time coordinate. And you can think about the image that you get if you, for example, fix x, so you just look at one scan line every image, And now you look at that as a function in time, you get some weird image which is like the smeared out data inside of your video sequence, right? And there are a lot of interesting filters that have to do with processing the motion in a video sequence. For example, like, can you exaggerate motion or detect where people are moving and so on, that essentially involve just slicing through that cube of numbers in a different way. Incidentally, the fancy word for a cube of numbers is tensor, in case you're wondering. Okay. Right. Of course, we should be careful to say we have arrays of what, and typically, we talk about arrays of grad gradient. So these are all really, really unsurprising concepts at this point in this class, I hope. So now, we actually have all the ingredients we need to start talking about some simple image filtering operations, and a lot of these actually probably at this stage in the A37 are pretty predictable. And really one of the fun things is I consider image processing, at least in the basic, obviously the advanced techniques get pretty tricky, but the basic techniques can get some really convincing, interesting effects with like very little code. And this is one of the really fun things about writing things in this area. So, for example, one of the simplest pieces of code that you might write is for a green screen. And does anybody know what a green screen is? So another word for this is compositing. So here's an image. And I tried to find a video with the most obvious compositing possible. And since your instructor enjoys throwbacks to things that broke the internet a long time ago, if you look at Rebecca Black's shoulder here, one thing you'll notice is, of course, the lighting on her shoulder has this weird greenish tinge here. And then there's this psychedelic background behind it. And of course, the question is, what's going on in this video? Can anybody explain, like, why in this music video, what is how come she has this funny shadow behind her, which doesn't seem particularly physical? Yeah.
Because they're basically mapping one green color as transparent and then putting another background behind it, but it's not correctly cutting up all of the different versions of green.
Exactly. So Rebecca here is singing about Friday in front of basically a blackboard, but now it's green. Yeah. And why do we choose green? Yeah.
There isn't a ton of green in people.
Yeah, exactly. Humans tend not to be green. And so Kermit the Frog perhaps would need a blue screen instead. But that aside, so she's singing in front of a green screen, and you can think of a very simple algorithm, which just looks at all the pixels in the image. Says, well, if they're close enough to green, I'm going to erase that pixel and replace it with the background color. And just like Magnus has pointed out here, what happens, well, the green screen actually reflects some light off of the screen and onto Rebecca's shoulder here. And now, unfortunately, as we learned in our color lecture, what do you get? You get the product between green and whatever the color of her shirt is. And maybe now that's distant enough from the bright green screen that the computer doesn't detect it. Out comes this kind of mixture of color. Yes?
I think it's probably because the scene of where in the studio they're probably lighting it and the green is bouncing off.
Absolutely. Yeah, so just like we point out, another issue here is that, for example, the background image that we choose is inconsistent with the lighting in the scene on Rebecca. And this causes two problems. One is that light actually bounces off the screen and onto her shirt. And the other is just that something non-physical ends up happening. One image with lighting behind her, and another of the actual lighting that's reflecting off of her shirt, and there's nothing that says they have to be the same. But anyway, this is our simplest image processing procedure, and it's an example of a technique that we call compositing. And basically, compositing is all about combining visual elements from different sources into a single image, and this is useful in a lot of different contexts, right? So, something that's come up a few times in this class is that the reality of the rendering pipeline for movie studios right now is that it doesn't just happen in one giant ray trace, but rather typically, a single frame in a video is rendered many, many times, right? So maybe, the Hulk has some bizarre skin that requires him to be ray traced, so we, ray trace him, and then we have, the video sequence in the background of all the characters running around, and then the foreground, I want to rasterize a bunch of spaceships moving in. And then these things are all combined together, and that process is also known as compositing. Yeah? Okay. And so typically in compositing, actually, rather than having just three colors per pixel, we have four. Yeah? And these are RGB, and then we're going to add a fourth channel here, which is called alpha. And the idea of alpha channel, which many of you guys have probably seen in the context of making a website, is that it's just some number which encapsulates the opacity of the pixel, right? And so roughly, if I have two images, then I can display them on top of each other, and then the alpha is going to tell me the fraction that I need when I blend them together. Okay? And so really the intuition that people typically have is that alpha is a fraction covered by the foreground layer. By the way, something that's worth noting here is that does alpha have to be that? That's just some other fourth number that's like carried around inside of an image. And you can imagine that there's some of the kind of specialized cases where maybe you're hacking your JPEG file to just have some other number inside. Actually, I'm not sure if JPEG has alpha, but certainly GIFs do. Okay. So how do you think alpha blending works? It's really, really simple. So maybe I have a foreground color and a background color, which is, you know, and so now I have this new foreground image which comes with alpha. So what do? Well, I take alpha times the foreground image plus 1 minus alpha times the background image. And so even in compositing, this is quite important, right? Because maybe what you try to do is detect pixels that are close to that interface between green and her shirt, and you put alpha to be like 1/2, so that at least there's a smooth transition from the background into the images that you have. Incidentally, so let's think about, do you guys remember, what is the Pagers algorithm? We mentioned this briefly when we talked about rasterization, but so what's the Pagers algorithm? Real simple. Yeah, so the Pagers algorithm is I have a list of things I want to draw, and I draw them one at a time. Yeah? And so for example, if I'm making tools like Photoshop, the Pagers algorithm makes complete sense. So like I have little sprites that I'm going to draw one on top of another, yeah, and then I rasterize them all, and alpha essentially tells me whether or not, when I put something on top of this stack, whether or not I actually draw it or not. But there's a subtle issue here, which is, let's say that I swap the order, right? I have like 1/3, 1/3, 1/3 for my alpha values. And now I use this formula and I stack 3 images on top of each other. Yeah? And I could flip the order that I draw these 3 things, right? If they're 1/3, 1/3, 1/3, maybe I feel like, you know, only 1/3 of the pixel should really receive the color of each of those 3 pieces. Is that what happens in reality? No, yeah. And so you have to be quite careful when you talk about these alpha techniques, that if you use the Pagers algorithm, we just sort of take whatever the old color was, scale it, and then put something on top, right? That's not symmetric operation. It actually depends which one you do first. And this is a subtle point that people often miss. Something else that's worth noting, computationally, I'd say in the 90s this mattered a lot more than now, but in case you see this term, people talk about pre-multiplied alpha a lot. The idea here is very simple, that typically, you know, if you have code that's doing alpha blending, it's evaluating this formula a bunch of times, right? And you're storing this foreground color, but you never actually need the foreground color, you just need alpha times the foreground color, so you might as well store that number instead to save yourself a multiply, right? So that's called pre-multiply alpha. And here's the result on a very 90s image here, right? So you can see that you can do compositing to put this gentleman, you know, on a beach scene, on blue stuff, and so on. And obviously you could composite on top of him as well by using another image. And as you guys pointed out, the big issue here, challenge is to put a color in the background that's as far away from possible as skin color. But actually recently people are reconsidering this issue, and it's exactly for the reason we pointed out. Actually that green color, well, what does it do? Effectively, as we know, when we talked about global illumination, you know, not all light that's received on the surface of the sky comes from the lighting of the scene. It also gets bounced off of this ugly, bright green screen, right? And so oftentimes you can kind of pick out movie scenes that have been green screened because everything has this light green tinge to it. And it's really hard to undo that, especially right at the interface between the person and the background. And so, there are a lot of interesting questions involving, like, can I choose maybe a color that's more natural or more aligned with the scene that I'm going to draw eventually in the background so that the illumination makes sense, but use a more advanced computer vision algorithm, for example, to separate out the background from the foreground? This is still a topic of research. In fact, there's a postdoc in the graphics group right now who studies these kinds of things. So it's a really interesting challenge. And of course, what happens when this stuff goes wrong? So here's a great example. Let's see if we can play this. Video clip here. So this is some news report, and apparently the news reporter here wore the wrong kind of outfit, and she's wearing a green shirt. This is what I'm doing. Okay. interesting things that you can do with the alpha channel here is just like, you know, remember when we talked about Boolean algebra with shapes and we did it in 3D? We can do something very similar with the alpha method, right? So, for instance, you could, you know, essentially have a whole compositing algebra which computes different alpha values for two different shapes that overlap, basically by giving sort of operations that say, well, if I see these two shapes, should I multiply their alphas together? Should I take the one with the bigger alpha value, and so on? And effectively, you can simulate, you know, over, under, in, out, and so on. Right? So these are just ways to kind of control that painter's alpha. So anyway, this is our simplest example of image processing, and you can see it's already pretty powerful. Right? What it allows you to do is essentially to carry out some kind of multi-pass rendering. You pass over, and you keep adding more and more layers to your scene, and just taking it on top on the places where it makes sense. Okay, and this is an example of an operation that takes place per pixel. You see that every single pixel gets processed one at a time, that like neighboring pixels don't communicate with each other in the compositing algorithm. And actually, I would say about 99.99999% of calculations that people do in image processing boil down to a really, really simple filter on pixel colors. So if we want to formalize that a tiny, tiny bit, then maybe, you know, if we're not compositing, we're just processing one image at a time, then it's effectively all we have is some function f that goes from RGB to f of RGB that just gives a new color, right? So for instance, in the sepia tone, you know, filters, what are you doing? You're taking these nice, bright, colored filters that you see in the real world and replacing them with kind of brownish colors. But the features in the image are all the same, right? You're just replacing colors one by one. And so we call these color space operations. Effectively, any filter that decouples over the different pixel locations, we'll call it a color space thing. Notice, by the way, that this is extremely well suited for GPU calculations. Single instruction, multiple data. Right? What is your single instruction in this case? It's just evaluating that function f, and your multiple data are all the colors of the pixels. Okay, so let's see some examples here. So, one very simple one is if I have a dark photograph and I want to make it lighter, what do I probably do? Let's just multiply the pixels by a number bigger than one, and now your image is bright. Yeah? This is, we're not doing anything too tricky. So. Yeah?
So for brightness, I know this one is wanting like higher value, another is just add a white with some alpha in front of people's pictures.
Absolutely, that's a great question. So Bayan asked a great question, which is, in fact, there are two ways to increase the brightness of an image. One would be to like add a little bit to every pixel color, and the other would be to multiply. What do you think the difference is? Somebody else? Anybody have any hypotheses? So think about black pixels. What happens to a black pixel if you add a constant to the whole image? It doesn't. There's no black anymore. It's gray. Yeah. I've just added a little bit of light coming out of that pixel. If I multiply the image, then effectively black stays black, and just the lighter stuff becomes even lighter. And so in the multiplied version of brightness, essentially what you're doing is increasing also the contrast a little bit, right? The difference between dark and light. Whereas if you just add something, you're actually decreasing the contrast. Because remember we talked in our last lecture about how our last lecture about how your eye is sensitive to differences in color. So the difference between black and anything but black is quite large. Whereas the distance subtractively between two bright colors maybe is not perceived quite as much. So if you add a constant to the whole image, probably what you'll get is a very low contrast, but brighter result. Yeah. And I think both of these things are used in practice, depending on what you do. The other one I guess you'd call changing the white point. Okay? Similarly, you could contrast. Does anybody have more generally? How could I increase the contrast of an image? So, what does it mean for an image to have low contrast? All the color values are in some small bracket, right? In other words, like you know, your pixels are capable of drawing things with brightness between 0 and 1, but in reality, maybe most of your pixels are between 0.25 and 0.75. Yeah. So how can I change the contrast of an image? Yeah, fine.
Increase the standard deviation and get clamp.
Yeah. So effectively, I could kind of stretch out colors in both directions and then clamp if they're smaller than 0 or bigger than 1, right? So in other words, I could compose my image with something like this. So let's say this plot here is a histogram of all the colors in the first image. This plot here is a histogram of all the colors in the second image. Right? Then one thing I could do is cook up this function, which essentially maps the smallest color to zero and the biggest color to one. Okay. And this is called the contrast function. Yep. Okay. Of course, I could also do the opposite of that and desaturate an image, which essentially is using exactly the same function but pushing stuff to the center instead. In fact, we could desaturate an image completely, and what does that mean? It probably means replacing an image with just its grayscale version, like on the right-hand side. It turns out this doesn't matter a whole lot, but perceptually, sort of the apparently the best grayscale weighted combination of red, green, and blue here looks something like this. You guys have any hypothesis? Why does green get the bigger weight? Exactly. So your eye is more sensitive to green. Yeah. So if you're computing, if you're converting from RGB to just a single grayscale value, you should probably give the green a bigger weight because that is the contrast that your eye is more likely to see. And so, roughly, I think these proportions are reflective of the proportion of the number of cones you have. Because again, remember that the way that we store images is for every pixel we have one red, one green, and one blue, but perceptually that's kind of a weird thing to do because our eye is less sensitive to blue than it is to red and green. And so effectively these kinds of formulas are trying to compensate for that a little bit. Okay, so more generally, operations like the one that I've told you, you can view as image histogram operations. I should remove this photograph, this cat. Image histogram here is what I've shown you in black and white in the center. And it's exactly what you think it is, right? So when people talk about image histogram, what they do is they take the interval between 0 and 1, right? And they bin it into, like, say, 100 little pieces, right? And then essentially, what you're plotting with this little crazy two-peaked function is here, is it's telling you that there's a lot of pixels with intensity value somewhere in this range, and then a lot of pixels with intensity value in that range. Probably that has to do with her hair and the diagonal line versus all the other kind of white stuff in this image. Right. And then a very typical user interface in the image processing world is to say, okay, well remember I can take the pixel colors and compose them with some function, which I'm going to design here. And what does that function effectively do? It kind of takes this histogram and it stretches it out or squashes it in different ways. Do you see that? So for example, if this function goes up and to the left, then effectively I'm going to take this peak and move it over there. Because right, I'm taking lighter pixels and making them darker. One thing you can do is very easily kind of preview the distribution of colors that you'll get from a different image filter that you design. And this is useful because it can kind of tell you whether you're using the dynamic range of your image in a good way, for an effective way. Incidentally, on the most extreme case of this, maybe you want to use every brightness level the same amount. Yeah? So this will be what we call histogram equalization, where you come up with some filter that takes this function and replaces it with one that is completely constant. In other words, every single grayscale value gets used the same way. Anybody have a proposal for an algorithm that will do this? There are actually a few options. That actually has to do with probability class too. So remember that, like, let's say I have a random variable that's distributed by some distribution. So for instance, your random variable might be color, and it's distributed by this funny distribution here. And you'd like to transform that distribution to a uniform one. Does anybody know the trick for this? To run it through the quantile. Right? So there's two different algorithms that are actually the same. One of them would be to take the list of colors of all the pixels in your screen, or in your image, and sort it. And now what you'll do is you'll take that long, long list, obviously it's a very long list of numbers, yeah, and now it's in increasing order, and I will make the interval between each of those colors the same, and then I'll replace the color that you currently have with just like 1 over n times your position in the list. If you think about it, that makes sure that like if one color is darker than another, that relationship is preserved, right? Because now every color gets the same, you know, the ordering hasn't changed. But the spacing between each color is the same, so that gives you a uniform distribution. Another way to do it, which is equivalent, is as follows. So let's say that I have a distribution. So let's say that this is x is like your intensity, and then p of x is the amount of sort of the number of pixels that have intensity x, right? And so if you normalize, this gives you some distribution like that, right? And okay, so if this is p of x, then we can define something called the cumulative distribution function. You guys remember what this is from probability class? So the cumulative distribution function CDF of x is the integral from 0 to x of p of x dx. Right? So what does that function look like? Roughly, it looks like. So, what do we know about the CDF of the uniformly distributed case? Right? So let's say that my CDF looks like that, right? Which would mean that every single pixel color gets used to exactly the same amount. Well, the CDF, I mean, this is a constant function, so the CDF is really simple. It's a line, right? And so effectively, what you want to do is find the transformation of this function that gives us a CDF that resembles this other guy's function, right? That's what we're after. And so essentially, the way that you can do that is to say that instead of using the pixel color, you do the inverse of this function, which essentially is just mapping the pixel to the sort of quantile that it lives in. And if you think about it, it's exactly the same as this this sorting algorithm script. So anyway, this is for histogram equalization, and people in medical imaging really like it, because if you think about it, your brain is probably a very low contrast image when it goes through the MRI, and the doctors don't really care about like having an attractive photograph. What they care about is having lots and lots of contrast between darks and lights, and so they typically will run images through very, very aggressive sort of contrast equalization algorithms to make sure that you can see every difference between every pixel and its neighbors, for example, because that's going to help you, you know, see if there's a tumor or not. In fact, they can also do this in kind of a local fashion. Maybe they just collect the histogram in some neighborhood. Okay, so that's our first example of a nonlinear filter. Okay, so anyway, all this is to say that there's, you know, essentially by just engineering functions that map from color to color, you can achieve a lot of interesting effects. Whether it's just increasing the contrast or doing something really complicated like equalizing the histogram of the colors. Yeah? How do you think people design these functions in practice? Yeah?
Drawn by hand.
And what tools do you think they use algorithmically for doing that? You can kind of see it in the slide here. Splines, yeah? So this is yet another case where splines appear in the computer graphics form, that you can define some funny function. By the way, what does it mean if this function is not increasing? Like if it increases then goes back down. It's like a really weird effect, right? Like what it would mean is that really light colors become dark, dark colors stay dark, and colors in the middle become bright, which is pretty uncommon, right? So I think a lot of user interfaces for this will kind of constrain you to have an increasing light. Although I guess they don't have to. Right, so now let's talk about some more complicated filters that are still just per pixel. So one of the big issues that shows up, especially in the computational photography world, is coping with what we call dynamic range. Right, so for instance, I think the typical example, like what you're seeing here, is a photograph of a church or a cathedral. In fact, the usual example is the Stanford Church, although this does not appear to be that. And what is the issue with these things? Well, if you're in like a big Gothic church, then you have these very tall arches and these big blocky marble objects here, which do a really great job of blocking light. Right? So there's like very little light in all these little alcoves on the side. And then what do you have, you know, right at the center of the church, which of course during church is where you're supposed to be putting all of your attention, is this giant display and a huge stained glass window in the background. And if you're really unlucky or you're really lucky, I don't know, then your church is somehow aligned with the sun right behind you. So what do you think happens? Well, right through that window, you have this huge burst of light, and everywhere else is extremely dark. And so this is an example of an image that we say has high dynamic range, meaning that there are areas of the image that are really, really dark and areas of the image that are really light. Yeah? And this is really a problem both for display and perception, as well as for just taking photographs. Right? So in the, when you're talking about taking a photograph, of course, remember how a camera works. You have this number, which is your exposure, which is roughly how long the camera stays open before it closes again, like how much time it takes, how much time you take collecting photons before you output an image. And what happens when you photograph the church is something really frustrating, right? Which is, let's say that I want to keep my camera open long enough to get enough photons from the really dark stuff on the side, right? To kind of get some detail there. What do you think happens to the center of the church? Light, right? And similarly, if I have a very quick exposure so that I can capture the interesting colors in that stained glass window, then on the sides of the church it just looks black. Yeah? And so this is a really frustrating issue. And it's completely physical, by the way. It's not like there's like some algorithm problem here, like this is just the way light works. Yeah? And by the way that your eye works, right? So like depending on what part of the church your eye focuses on, probably effectively the shutter in your eye will open or close. But of course, if I'm displaying the church as a photograph, then that's not good enough, right? Because I don't know where people are going to look, and they probably want to get a sense for the entire room in one shot. Yeah? So that leads to this idea of high dynamic range photography, which was really, I would say, a huge focus of the image processing world for quite some time. Right? The idea that like, even if you have the best camera in the world, you're going to suffer from this issue, which is depending on the number of stops of your exposure, you can either get the interesting color in the bright part of your image, or in the dark part of your image, or the interesting color in the bright part, but not both. Yeah. And of course, real-world scenes have really nasty dynamic ranges. So if you have a sunny landscape, the dynamic range, like the range between sort of the darkest pixel and the brightest one, could be like 100,000 to 1, and so on. So I guess here, this is the dynamic range of an outdoor scene, and these are like the dynamic ranges that assorted capture display devices can actually give you. Of course, a camera on a standard display can do fairly well. They can get 1,000 to 1, but already the dynamic range is nowhere close to what a sunny landscape can give you. And actually, high dynamic range imaging particularly matters when you're designing print publications, right? So if you're the person writing software in Adobe for Photoshop, then really carefully treating this issue matters quite a bit, because the reality is the dynamic range of your printer on like a sheet of paper is extremely low, but you'd like the, you know, maybe you're making a, you know, a brochure for your favorite resort. You want that resort not to just like look like, you know, look like a burst of light, but like as a nice fun place that you want to spend your vacation at. And so you have to do some really careful image processing to make that translate from what your eye would actually see in the real world to the best representation you can get on a sheet of paper. And there are a lot of really cool techniques for doing this. One of the neat ones is the idea of exposure fusion. So in exposure fusion, maybe I set up my camera on a tripod, and I say, okay, well, I know that one exposure of a photograph is just not gonna be enough to capture all the interesting detail. So what do I do? Well, instead, maybe I take 4 photos and with different stops on my camera. Yeah, and so what do I get? I get a photo on the left-hand side that has nice detail, in certain parts of the image. A photo on the right-hand side, which has nice detail in the brighter parts of the image. And now, through the magic of image processing, I can combine all of these things together. Right? There's some totally reasonable heuristics for how to do this, right? Because essentially, for every pixel, what are you trying to do? You're trying to find, among the 4 exposures, the one that has sort of the most interesting color, right? Isn't just black or white. Now, there are a lot of different algorithms for how to do that. Can anybody tell me some drawbacks of exposure fusion? What goes wrong? Like, do you think your phone, at least your phone maybe a couple years ago, did this by default? You got it. So let's say that I'm taking a photograph of a basketball game, and I do exposure fusion, and the ball is dribbling. What do you think I'll see in the fused image? I'll see like 4 basketballs instead of 1, because maybe they all get fused together, and it's like. Right? Or for example, your instructor suffers from a slight tremor, and so when I take photos on my phone, it's really frustrating because they're always blurry. And it gets even worse if I use exposure fusion, because now I have all these different misaligned photographs that I'm averaging together. Right? So you can compensate for that a little bit, especially in that case, by just noticing the image probably doesn't change that much, and you can kind of align them and then fuse, which I think is typically what people do. But of course, if things are moving in the scene, then you're sort of hosed from the start, unless you do something really, really tricky. Okay. So related to exposure fusion is this idea of tone mapping. I think maybe 5 years ago, tone mapping got a little too popular, and we all saw photographs that kind of looked like this thing in the middle, which I'd argue is maybe not artistically the best result, but somehow it's very dramatic looking. People are excited that they could do this kind of effect. The idea of tone mapping is that there are a lot of different ways to map the colors in a scene to the colors that are displayable on your screen. Notice those are two different sets of colors. And perceptually, you might not want to do it linearly, right? So, like, if we return to we were discussing with Bion originally, right? We could essentially take the brightest color in your scene, scale it to one, and display on the screen, right? But then there's pretty good odds that the contrast will actually be weird perceptually, because what your eye cares about are differences between things rather than just absolute brightness colors. Yeah? And to make matters worse, that tends to be local. Right, so if you have a scene with like a little brightness difference on the left-hand side and a little brightness difference on the right-hand side, it could be that you process those differently because the context is slightly different in those two places. Okay? And so tone mapping algorithms have all kinds of clever ways to essentially accentuate all of the differences between nearby pixels that you can see in an image while being constrained to the displayable range. Yeah? And so you can see that tends to create these kind of, sometimes a little grainy, if you do it poorly, right? I mean, obviously, Fredo, and if you take Fredo's class, you'll learn how to do this in a very nice way. One thing to note is that if you just linearly map the tone range, like we've already talked about, then what tends to happen is you have a very flat and dark image. Right? Why is that? First of all, why is it probably dark? Let's say I have a single highlight in my photograph that's like reflecting some really shiny objects. Well, now all of a sudden, the rest of my photograph has a scale down to compensate for that one tiny highlight. And then, well, why does it look flat? Well, now I've taken all the interesting colors and I've scaled them down to a very small range. Yeah. And so that's what tends to happen. So how do you think we compensate for that? Well, there's sort of two things that are worth noting. Right? One is that perception is local, right? Like that you typically judge a pixel by its neighbors. And the other is that perception is non-linear. Like, remember we talked about the gamma value on your computer screen? And why do we have gamma? Well, this gamma's role. Remember, gamma was some nonlinear map of pixel colors. It was an exponential. And it took, essentially, that little range of gray values, and it stretched it out a little more than if you just did linear intensity. And the reason is that perception tends to be kind of on a logarithmic scale. Right? Like, so if I take an intensity and I multiply it by 10, probably we're computer scientists, I shouldn't have a 2 there, but whatever. Then essentially, you know, the amount that your perception changes of that color probably shifts by about 1. Obviously the units here are non-existent, but the idea here is that if you just keep adding 1 unit of light to a pixel, you won't keep perceiving it as changing 1 unit into And that makes a lot of sense, right? It's like really good that your eye works this way, because like there are so many different scenarios where you like walk from a dark room into like a bright outdoors, and you wouldn't want like your whole visual system to just like explode, right? And so that's roughly why your eye has a logarithmic response. So what do you think the simplest tone mapping algorithm is that doesn't just like rescale the pixel colors? Given what I have on the slide. Logarithmic, exactly. So what I'm arguing here is that somehow perception is roughly linear in the log of your image. So what do? I take the log of every pixel color in one pass, then I rescale those logs to be between 0 and 1, or between, you know, I guess in whatever range that you want, not quite 0 and 1. And then I take the exponent, and this thing is much more likely to give you an effective tone map, and it's just as easy to code. And so here's the result. If your instructor were more clever, he would have put them next to each other, which of course now is quite hard to see. Yeah, I think if you look at this, in this little circle here, you can see that there's like a reasonable contrast between the dark gray and the light. Okay, so what you end up with is brighter dark regions. So that makes sense, right? Because before you took the entire dark kind of band of pixel colors and just squashed them down to nothing. And here, you know, if you could have two dark colors that were multiplied by two by each other. So the difference between them is still small, but the, you know, from a scale perspective, it's quite large, and that would be accounted for just by taking. Yeah. Of course, there's a small issue here, which we just pointed out, which is that if you have a black pixel, what happens? Take the log of zero. Yeah. So probably in reality, what you have to do is add some epsilon to your image, then take the log, and then cancel all that out of G. All right, so this is the simplest tone mapping algorithm, and it does at least fix one issue, which is that your perception is logarithmic in intensity. But it doesn't fix a different issue, which is that your perception is local. Like, when you look at a pixel, you tend to just sense the pixels that are around it. And the sad fact here is that most interesting image filters involve more than one pixel, which is only sad because it makes it more difficult to cut. In particular, your GPU is really, really good at just touching one pixel at a time. And we've actually seen, although we haven't talked about them in an image processing standpoint, quite a few algorithms that process more than one pixel simultaneously. So the simplest one is shown here, which is image recycling. Yep. So here is a picture of my mom's cat. Her name is Samantha. And if we take Samantha and we shrink her smaller and smaller and smaller, then what do you notice? Well, one pixel in this tiny cat here corresponds to a pretty large piece of the image there. And so probably what we have to do is take some sort of integral around some region to use in the color. Incidentally, should we use uniform weights for that integral? Or should we just draw a square here and sum up over the square and ignore all the neighbors? No. What should we use? Bicubic, so that would be for making it larger, but if we're trying to shrink the image, sink, right? In particular, let's say that instead of the Samantha here, I had a photograph which was a checkerboard, right? And I got very unlucky, and I divided my image exactly in half, right? Then depending on the alignment of the checkers with the bound, like if I just sort of summed up everything inside of a square that corresponds to a single pixel in the smaller image, then essentially all you would see in that smaller image was the alignment of that square with the checkerboard. Whereas what you really like are sort of smooth weights that drop off, which is perceptually the better thing to do. Remember, that's what we argued a few weeks ago in this class. And of course, this is important in so many different contexts, right? We talked about rasterizing texture triangles. So, you know, when you shrink an image, you know, you have this really disgusting, high detail hand texture that you'd like to wrap over this model, which is far away from the camera, then you're going to have to summarize the pixels inside of the same thing. And exactly the same techniques apply, as well as the same issues that we've already talked about. Yeah. So in general, if you'll recall, this is the task that we call minification, which is making an image smaller. And the basic issue that you have to account for is that small distances become large. Right? In other words, this distance, like in inches on the computer screen, if I keep the same distance and put it here, of course, now they become large as a sort of relative to the size of the photo. Yeah? And so what do we do? Well, for every pixel here, it's some weighted average here, and we probably use a nice sync or bicubic set of weights. And that's exactly the interpolation idea that we talked about. Okay. And so in the language that we've already discussed, this is some kind of weighted interpolation. Now similarly, I can take an image and I can make it bigger, so now I'm going to do the reverse. I have a very small photograph of Samantha, and I take the corners and I drag them outward, and I have a large one. We've already talked about how to do that as well. One thing to notice, when I make a photograph larger, unlike maybe in rendering where like I could send more rays, I have no more information here. You guys see that? So when I make it larger, I expect the quality to sort of degrade, right? Essentially, I'm adding signal where there isn't any. So we talked about one very simple technique for doing that, which is just by linear interpolation. So roughly, when I make Samantha bigger, I could think about it like she has pixels that are kind of spaced far apart, in the image, and now there's a bunch of pixels whose color I don't know, so I'm just going to interpolate linearly along those lines. But one thing we didn't talk about is that that doesn't have to be the only algorithm that you use for image resizing. In particular, what do we know about typical photographs of the real world is that they, for example, they contain a lot of sharp edges. But what happens if I just bilinearly interpolate across a sharp edge? I get this like smooth linear drop-off, which is not so good. And similarly, for those of you guys who have taken machine learning, maybe one thing that you know is that the space of like patches, 3x3 patches of pixels that you have just from natural photographs is distributed very differently than the space of all possible 3x3 patches of pixels. Does that make sense? That in other words, like the space of photographs is not the space of all possible images, but rather a much, much smaller set. Right? And so actually, this suggests that tools like machine learning and image filtering are extremely important for actually image resizing. So let's say that I take this really tiny photograph of like a knot or whatever it is, and I magnify it just this little square here. If I use bilinear interpolation, I get a result that looks something like on the upper right, which I think you guys have all seen before if you play with PowerPoint or anything else. But you can actually invent much more intelligent image processing tools that, for instance, upsample an image and notice like, oh, there's a diagonal line here, and that's the feature that I want to preserve when I increase the size of my image instead of just interpolating on a pixel grid. Yeah. And so there are a lot of different names for this problem. One of them is called inpainting. And so for example, maybe I have a photograph and I just erased a little piece of the photograph and I want to fill it in. Well, which is effectively, hopefully you guys can see, that's exactly the problem we're solving here. You can imagine two ways to do that. One would be to just fill in like the smoothest function in between, you know, the known pixels. And what you get is something like the top row. Another thing that you could do these days, this is a very modern idea, is like download all of Flickr and say, okay, what if I find the Flickr photograph that is as close as possible to the thing that I want to upsample. And now, I'm going to take this little patch of images, or this little patch of pixels, rather, find a similar patch in a larger image, and basically just use that, maybe modulated by the color of the image that I have, and glue that inside of my images and inpaint it. Okay? And this is actually the beginning of a modern thread in image processing research. And I think the really fundamental technique that people proposed, gosh, about 10 years ago now, was an algorithm called Patch Match, which really does exactly that. So what it does is you download a big database of photographs, and it takes every photograph and it breaks it down into, like, say, 10 by 10 little patches of pixels. So each of those patches is maybe not semantically interesting, but it contains sort of interesting photograph features. And I would say, okay, well, if I'm trying to upsample an image or fill in a missing hole or something like that, well, rather than just interpolating in a boring way, I'm going to try and make a little patchwork of these image patches from my database that fills in the space as well as possible. And the reason that I do that is that those patches already come from photographs, so I think that they have the interesting features that I want. So I encourage you guys to Google for patch match and see. There's some really impressive results with that technique, which is pretty simple. And of course, since then, deep learning has become very popular. Essentially, the extensions of patch match include more interesting features. Okay. Of course, one thing that's worth noting that maybe didn't matter for texturing quite as much, but if you make a 2D computer graphics tool, it's quite important, is that, you know, when we resample, we can also stretch things, we can rotate them, and so on. In fact, another thing which is an assignment in some of my old graphics classes but this semester is you could implement image filters that maybe you pin a few points and you kind of drag the image in different ways to deform it. And so really, these kinds of filtering techniques are just as applicable, though, but you have to be careful to do it locally instead of apply the same rule to every pixel. And so these types of rules are essentially instances of something we've talked about a little bit, which is this idea of convolution. Right? So remember how convolution works. So the idea is I have some input signal, so for example this blue function here, and I have something we'll call a convolution kernel. So that in this case would be this red function here. We call this the rect function for obvious reasons. Yeah? and the convolution of one function against another, what I do is I drag this red filter across, and effectively I just measure the integral of the product of these two things, or a different way of thinking about it is the overlap between these two curves. Right? And that's the output color that I get in. Right? And so convolution more generally, well, it's used, for example, to blur out images. Right? So here, the convolution kernel will be like the blurring weights, which I'm going to kind of just move across the image and then multiply the image by the blurring weights and so on. Yep, exactly the same procedure. Okay, so let's take a look at what that looks like. So let's say that I have a photograph here, and so my photograph is of a checkerboard, and I want to convolve it with this kernel here. Notice that this kernel kind of peaked at the center, and then it drops off as I go outward. Then what does convolution do? Well, it's going to take this green guy and superpose it on top of the image on the left-hand side. Hopefully that's what you see here. And now, my convolution algorithm is going to say, what is the color at this red facial? Well, I'll take the green filter and place it on top of the image, multiply those two things together, and sum up. Right? So in other words, I'm going to take mostly this pixel, but also some of the colors of the other guys nearby, and I'm going to drag this thing across. Right? So here's going to be this color, you know, then I move the filter across, and I get something like that. So do you guys see what happens? So roughly, well, in these two pixels, they get the same color because the green filter only overlaps with the one piece of the checkerboard. But now, when I move to the next filter pixel, you're starting to see a little bit more of the black, more and more, and effectively it smooths it. What was one detail that I just skipped in this picture? The boundary, exactly. Effectively, notice that the very first pixel I chose was here, and the reason is that's the very first place where I could squeeze the entire convolution kernel. So what do you think happens on the left-hand side? Exactly. So as Magnus suggests here, you have to say what happens on the left-hand side. Because there really is no color on this photograph here, right? So if I place the convolution kernel at this pixel here, I have to decide what color to use. And there are a lot of different options, right? So one of them, called periodic boundary condition, says, okay, if I go off the edge here, then I should look on the other side. Right? So this is useful, for example, for textures that you expect to repeat a bunch of times. Another one would be to say, well, if I go off the end here, then just clip it and use the pixel color that's closest to the side. I think those are the two most common ones. And you'll see, like if you play with Photoshop, that they just give you the option. Okay. And that gives you the full set of pixel colors. Okay, so there's a few things worth. By the way, a third boundary condition, which is a little bit fishy, is just to assume that your image is zero outside of the boundary. This is the easiest one to code, but not necessarily the most. Okay, so there are a lot of different properties that your kernel has. One is that it integrates to one. By the way, remember from our slide on the beginning of lecture, when I say integrate, I just mean that your weights sum up to one. Otherwise, what happens when you convolve your image in the kernel is maybe it gets brighter or darker. It's just because the imaging weights were too big or too small. And that it's relatively small, I should say relatively small spatially. And the reason for that is that, well, at least with the algorithm described for you so far, what is the time complexity? So to get like the color at one of these pixels, I need to iterate over this 3x3 patch. Yeah? I have to multiply that by the size of this image. Yeah. So in other words, it's the product of the number of pixels in the image by the number of pixels in the kernel, which would be really quite big if the kernel were like the same size. We'll see that that's not necessarily the case. There are better ways to do that. But the reality is actually, I think in a lot of image processing software for small kernels, what I just described for you is more or less what's implemented, and that turns out to be the fastest. But let's take a look at a few different kernels here. So here's the Taj Mahal, and here's a blurring kernel. You can see it does exactly what you might expect, which is to blur things out. Let's say that I wanted to find edges in my photograph. Like, you know, for instance, you know, I have Rebecca Black against the green screen, and I want to do some special alpha, you know, processing right at the interface between these two things. So I want to detect edges. Remember, edges are places where pixel color changes quickly. So how could I find this? Fourier transform. That's kind of heavy. Could I come up with a convolution kernel that detects edges? Well, the simplest edge detector just takes a pixel and subtracts the average of its neighbors, right? And what happens? Well, if a pixel is very different from its neighbors, well, then it's probably not an edge, right? And so that's this edge detection kernel. I forget Do you guys remember what is the name of this particular kernel? Like, one fourth, and minus one. That's not the canny edge detector quite. It's this close. But anyway, you can see the result here, which is, like, for example, in the background here, obviously these blue pixels are very similar to the blue color of the neighbors, so you just get zero, whereas pixels right on the boundary here, you get something else. Okay? And of course, there are actually some really interesting kind of funny filters you can cook up. So for instance here, this is something people call an embossed filter, where you kind of want to make it look like things are lifted up a little bit over each other. So the way that you can do that is kind of to emphasize the difference between a pixel and the neighbors up into its left or something like that. Right? And the result is displacement of the colors. Okay. So if we talk about convolution the way that I described for you here, the algorithm looks something like this, right? So for every pixel, then you iterate over every pixel in the convolution kernel and come up. And like we already talked about, if you have an n by n image and an m by m kernel, then the algorithm takes n squared time. So you have a megapixel image, and you had a megapixel sized kernel, you'd be in a lot of trouble. Yeah? But luckily, there's a lot of different algorithms that accelerate that. One is Fourier, as our colleague suggests here. There's an issue with Fourier, if you'll know, it's okay, which is that Fourier transforms can contain negative numbers. Photographs typically do not, and if there are rounding issues, you can run into some trouble there. But negative numbers will pop up all over the place, right? So for instance here, remember we talked about replacing the sinc function with some positive approximations that we don't run into. And in fact, probably the most common thing that we might want to do to an image is just to blur it out, right? Because of course if you blur out an image, then you can minify it pretty easily just by like taking every other pixel, for example. Okay. So what do we know about blurring an image out? There's actually a lot of different properties that happen there. So here, I've replaced sinc with just a Gaussian. Remember, this looks like e to the minus x squared. Well, for one thing, it integrates to 1. We know that. It's got a pretty small kernel, assuming that you're not making some huge blur. It's positive. And then there's one additional property, which is extremely, extremely important, and is what makes image blurring really, really fast, which is that it's separable. In particular, what is a Gaussian? Well, it looks like, you know, e to the minus, I guess I should, the distance like that. I can expand the square and write this thing as a product of something nice, it's like pi. And what I get is a really interesting property, which is that if I convolve a filter which looks like Gaussian in x and constant in y, with another filter which is Gaussian in y and constant in x, then what I get is a Gaussian distribution of x and y jointly. This is called a separable property. So you can see it here. So what I did is what figure 24.7 did is was took, you know, just a one-dimensional function and then kind of repeat it vertically and then convolve it against this other thing in the vertical direction. And notice if you take a look at these numbers, you get like 255 and they drop down to 0 in all of the different directions. This is a really, really interesting property to have, because what it implies is that, in fact, it's enough to be only really good at convolving images against one-dimensional functions. Right, so if I want to blur a photograph out, what do? I first just blur out each of the rows independently. Right, so I smear the image horizontally, and then I smear it vertically, and this is equivalent to smearing across space completely. And why does that matter? So, algorithmically, right, if we go back to our estimate here, effectively I just shaved off that square. Yeah? So now I can have a pretty big blur without a lot of algorithmic cost. And in fact, I'll argue that we can do that even faster. Yeah? So that's our first property to notice, that it's enough to just blur stuff in one dimension, and then if we blur in x and then in y, then we blurred it too. And I think that's pretty intuitive anyway. Yeah? The other thing to notice, how many of us have heard of the central limit theorem? You probably haven't thought about it in the context of image processing. But let's say that I take any function and I convolve it with itself enough times. So effectively, like, maybe I use a box and then I blur out a box. In fact, I should have done this in MATLAB before class, but let's pretend like this blackboard is MATLAB and I'll show you the experiment that we're going to do. Okay? So So here's a box. Let's say that I can mold that with another box filter. What do I get? Well, think about what happens. You have this box that's sliding across the x-axis. You have 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0. Then suddenly the corner of the box touches this guy, and it increases linearly. And then eventually they align. You get up 100%. And then it's just decreasing again. So in reality, you get a function that looks like a triangle. Yeah. Okay. So now, let's say that I take a triangle function like that. I convolve it with the box. You get, well, if you think about it, you kind of get 0, 0, 0, 0. Now I'm convolving a box and a line, so I get a parabola, right? Because it looks like the area under a triangle, which is quadratic. And then I get another parabola when I start touching this segment as well. So roughly, this looks like this. You have a little parabolic piece, and another parabolic piece, another parabolic piece, and 0. If I convolve this again, what do you think happens? I get a bunch of cubics that look a little bit more like that. What does this look like? Looks like a bell curve. It looks roughly like, which is really what we're after. Blur stuff out. But it turns out this isn't a mistake. That one of many ways to understand the central limit theorem is if I take almost any function and I convolve it with itself. By the way, almost any is actually a formal term mathematically. And I convolve it with itself enough times, it begins to look like a Gaussian distribution. So why does this matter for image processing? Oh yeah, I didn't have to do this before. I forgot this in the slides. Yeah. So here, let's say I have a box. I convolve it with another box. I get two triangles. Let's say I convolve that with the box. I get a piecewise quadratic. I convolve that with the box. I get a piecewise cubic. And you can see that pretty quickly, these things begin to resemble. So why does that matter? Well, okay, so some image filters are easier to apply than others. Okay? The Gaussian is kind of annoying, like, especially like, let's say I want to blur an image with a really, really big kernel, right? Well, then algorithmically that's going to take me a long time because the kernel is really wide. But maybe there's some other filter whose kernel is also wide but is much easier to apply. And what can I do? I could just like apply that 10 times and know in the back of my head that roughly what I got was a Gaussian blur. Yeah? And in fact, that's sort of the one of the state-of-the-art techniques for blurring out an image. So let's say that I wanted to convolve an image with a box. So in other words, I want to replace every pixel with an average of like all the pixel colors that are like 3 to the left and 3 to the right. Right? Well, so how could I go about doing that? In fact, let's say that I just have one. I want to take every pixel and then replace it with like 1/3, 1/3, 1/3 as the average. Okay, so the convolution kernel is really simple. It's like zeros, 1/3, zeros. Here's my question. What is the difference between the color at this pixel and the color at this pixel after I convolve the box?
Only differs by one pixel.
Exactly. So remember, I have 1/3 plus 1/3 plus 1/3 for the left pixel. Then I have 1/3 plus 1/3 plus 1/3. Yeah. Well, I have two pieces that remain the same. And effectively, the only thing that changes is here and here. And in fact, no matter how wide my box filter is, that's true. Right? So this is a really, really wide kernel that I can evolve in linear time. Right? I don't need to iterate over the kernel. Yeah. So I have this very simple algorithm. What I do is I add the contribution here, and I remove it there, and I have this sort of running thing, which is the box filter applied to it. That makes sense? This is a sliding window trick, it's what we call it. Okay, so here's the really cool thing. This filter I can do ridiculously, ridiculously fast, even if it's really wide. Yeah? So if I want to have a really nice Gaussian convolution, what do? I just do this 3 times over the line, and suddenly I'm convolving against this thing, which is a really nice approximation of what I really want. Yeah? And so that's really what we can do in practice. So our two pieces for Gaussian convolution that are important, one is just to notice that it's okay to blur in X and then in Y rather than doing both. And then for the X blur, we can do this cool box filter trick and just iterate it a few times to do this blazingly fast. Yeah.
I mean that, like, is there like a mathematical proof of how K converges as compared to box size?
There is, yeah. So this is the central limit theorem tells you how that works.
Is there like a rough estimate on
the runtime here is very simple, right? Because it's linear runtime.
Oh no, as in like.
You mean the number of times you have to iterate.
You have to iterate to get like an epsilon error.
I think it's quadratic conversions, but I could be wrong. But yeah, there are two ways to go about that. Either you find the right theorem, which I know exists, but I've forgotten it right now, or you just, it's so fast that you can literally just try it and see if you got the plug that you want. And of course, one thing to notice here is that this is an approximate Gaussian convolution. But remember this picture that we drew, like even in like three iterations, it's a really good approximation that's often good enough for our purposes. Yeah. Incidentally, this pattern for algorithms is really useful in a lot of different contexts in image processing. So how many of you guys have heard of the median filter or click that button in Photoshop? So the median filter, what it does is it replaces the color in a pixel with the median of the colors of the pixels in some neighborhood of that pixel. So what do you think the trick for the median filter is? It's exactly the same, right? That I move this neighborhood along the image, and what do I need to compute a median? I need a sorted list of pixel colors. So what do? I remove the items in the sorted list on the left side of the median and add them on the right side, and it's kind of like a priority queue data structure, right? A really clever trick. Yeah. Of course, there are a lot of different algorithms for Gaussian convolution. Another one that's a more multi-scale is to use a pyramid, where essentially rather than having a sliding box, you just sort of shrink an image a bunch of times and then figure out the right weights to combine these things to approximate the Gaussian. But the main takeaway here is that details really matter. Today we have an animal theme, and so I think this is Andrew Adams' pet dog, at least that's 10 years ago. I don't know if this dog is still around. And what I've done is implemented an algorithm that just rotates an image. It's really easy to implement this, just look backward and do like bilinear interpolation. And one thing I could do is take Andrew's dog and rotate it 12 times and make it go in a circle, and that's what I've done here. Notice that it's black around the outside because I've just ignored boundary conditions. But a really curious thing happens here. Well, I could rotate 5 degrees 72 times, or I could rotate 1 degree 360 times. What happened? Well, every time I rotated, I made a slight error with my computation. This is a great example. We have to be extremely careful how you implement, for example, photo editing tools. Because if you have a slight bug in your rounding, for example, you can get in a lot of trouble. So for example, in this image, what I've used was something called the Lanzosch 3 sampling thing. So remember that there's like bilinear sampling for images, and then you can have better approximations of sync. What's one issue with sync is that it contains slightly too big numbers and slightly too small numbers, right? But if I don't convolve them in just the right way, well, what happens? Well, I have these negative numbers, which are going to start pushing pixels towards zero. I have numbers that are bigger than one, which are going to make it really, really big. And at the end of the day, I accidentally replace my image with really disgusting, scary things. Okay, so there's something worth noting. A couple last image filters that are also worth noting. One is called the unsharp mask. So this is a different way to increase the contrast of a photograph. So remember, we talked about increasing contrast by just rescaling the log. The unsharp mask is also dealing with this case that says your eye just judges intensity locally. So what does it do? Well, now that I have a Gaussian blur, I have a blurred out version of my image, I also still have the original sharpened image. One thing I could do would be blur out the image and then try to increase the difference between the blurred one and the unblurred one. You see that? So I have some blurred out color, and now what I'm going to do is scale the difference between my original image and the blurred out one to really emphasize sharp edges. That looks like this. So here, this is notation for blur the image out. And then what I'm going to do is add beta times the difference between these two guys. Notice when beta is equal to 1, this just gives me the image back. When beta is bigger than 1, it says actually take those sharp edges and accentuate them. Of course, there's a drawback of this, which is it can create interesting features in your image where there weren't any. So here's an example where I took just a flat spiral and I ran the unsharp mask, and of course now I get these sort of brightness edges that you see here, right? Because the blurred out guy isn't aware of this edge here. This is called a halo artifact, and actually I think if you look at a lot of magazine print, you tend to see this in practice, although maybe now in the last couple of years they fixed it. And depending on who you talk to, this is either a bug or a feature, right? It's sort of a bug in that obviously there's a visual artifact here that isn't in the original image. It's also a feature because it really helps you see that sharp edge. Of course, one way to fix it would be to replace that Gaussian blur that you're accentuating with something that knows about edges, right? And there's lots of algorithms out there for that. And in fact, this is sort of an example of a linear filter. Right? Obviously, if I add two images together and then convolve them, then that's the same as convolving and then adding. And an issue with linear filters, like the Gaussian, is that they're not aware of edges, right? Which makes sense, right? Like, I'm just dragging this little bump across the image, and it doesn't know if, like, it shouldn't really average things between dark and light. It just doesn't see them, right? It just blasts across the edge. And so there's some really interesting literature on essentially edge-preserving blurring, but necessarily that's got to be knowledgeable about the features inside of the image. So one of the really simple ones that we all know and love in the computer graphics world is something called the bilateral filter. The idea of the bilateral filter is I'm going to take the filter at a pixel, and I'm just going to zero out parts of the filter where the color of the image is far away from the color of the info pixel. In other words, I'd like to take a weighted average of colors, but only the colors that are kind of close to this value here, because those are the ones that I expect to blur out. But I see a sharp edge, and I don't want to blur on the other side. So one thing I could do is, as I move my convolution kernel along the image, I can just kind of scale it by the difference in intensity between the center pixel and the nearby guys. So this is an interesting idea in concept, but of course in algorithm it's hard to carry out because of some nonlinearity. Right? So all these nice tricks that I described to you no longer apply. There's some really beautiful algorithms for applying the bilateral filter that we don't have time to talk about today, but I'm happy to sketch them out for you later. But for now, here's a nice example. So here is an input photograph. If I apply a pretty aggressive Gaussian blur to her, you can see all the interesting features go away. Whereas if I apply the bilateral, you can see, for example, the dark pixels get kind of blended together, the light ones get blended together, but the edges are conserved. So a more aggressive version of this is the median filter, which is really useful when your noise isn't just Gaussian, like, you know, kind of just shot, but rather you have what we call shot noise, like just every once in a while a pixel is no good. Or in this extreme case, we just removed a bunch of pixels. The reason why the median is so robust is because at the end of the day, it only cares about one color, which is the median, as opposed to trying to average a bunch of stuff. Okay, so anyway, that's our crash course in image processing for the day. On Thursday, we're going to have graduate students from the graphics group who are going to come tell you all about their research. So we're going to have every one of them talks for 5 or 10 minutes about a very technical problem, so you can get exposed to the kind of things that we think about.